Welcome again, everybody, to AP Calculus AB. Today we've got our Chapter 6 review. Man, we're closing into the end of our Calc 1, I guess you could say, content out of the textbook, with just a few sections out of Chapter 7 left to go. And we're almost there. So in Chapter 6, what we were learning about was further expanding upon this idea of an antiderivative and kind of looking at how we could apply that in some situations. And we also looked at differential equations and separation of variables. So expect to see a lot of those mechanics show up, as well as connecting what an integral means into some problem solving. So without further ado, let's take a look. So we open up with some definite integrals. And we're supposed to find these analytically, meaning we need to show all of our steps. However, a calculator is allowed for this entire test. So realize that I do give you a reminder that you can verify your solutions using numeric integration or Math 9 in your calculator if we wanted to double check. So again, I don't think we'll need to do that, but it's nice to know that we do have a way of checking and seeing if our answer is correct. I'm not going to show any of that calculation work on this video, but just so you know, there will be a way to do that. All right, so here for our first example, we've got a 2x minus 1 for our integrand. We're going from negative 5 to 3. This one looks like a straightforward anti-differentiation problem. Now, you do not have to put this on your actual test or anything like that. I just want you to be able to kind of connect what type of integration technique with the integral itself. So this is anti-differentiation. All right, and a 2x had to come from an x squared, and a minus 1 had to come from a minus x. So that's what I'll be evaluating from negative 3 to 5. Okay, and I'm just going to quickly check here by derivating. 2x derivates to 2, or sorry, x squared derivates to 2x, good, and negative x derivates to negative 1, so I feel good about this antiderivative. Now I'm going to show the evaluation. First, I'm going to plug in my upper bound. 5 squared is 25 minus 5. Then minus, let's plug in our lower bound, negative 3 squared is a positive 9, and then minus a negative 3 is plus 3. So what I've really got is 20 minus 12, my answer is 8. And if I were to check that with a Math 9, I've done all the checking work ahead of time, 8 is the correct answer. But just so you know, if this ends up being a decimal or something, you could confirm that with your calculator. I think that's important to remind you of that. All right. Now here, this problem number 2, this looks like an absolute mess, but believe it or not, this is just a straightforward antiderivating problem. So we're just going to use antidifferentiation here because I can rewrite this integral by cleaning up my integrand. So what I've got for the integral is u to the 1 half times u to the first plus u to the 2 thirds du. And so I'm able to actually distribute this in and use the power rule. So from 0 to 1, I've really got u to the 3 halves plus u to the, let's see, 1 half plus 2 thirds. 1 half plus 2 thirds would be the same thing as 3 sixths plus 4 sixths. So that's 7 over 6, isn't it? And that is du. So now we can antiderivate u to the 3 halves. Well, it had to have a u to the 5 halves before I derivated, and I just need a coefficient that will cancel out that 5 halves when it multiplies out front. I want the coefficient to be 1, so the reciprocal is going to work here. And the same thing is going to happen here. I know that I needed to start off with like u to the 13 over 6, and I need something that will cancel out that 13 over 6 out front to give me my coefficient of 1. Now, I know 13 over 6 is kind of an outrageous kind of power to have, but take a look at our bounds. This is actually quite friendly to work with. All right, so I'm just going to quickly check. Okay, 5 halves goes out front, completely cancels out with this 2 fifths to leave a 1. 5 halves drops to 3 halves. 13 over 6 times 6 over 13, yep, they're reciprocals. That's going to be a 1, and 13 over 6 minus 1 would be 7 over 6. Okay, I feel good about that. So I've got 2 fifths times 1 to the 5 halves is just going to come out as a 1, won't it? Plus 6 over 13 times 1. Again, 1 to any power will be 1, as long as it's not something we'll talk about later. All right, that's my upper bound. And then my lower bound, man, I really like working with this because zero, whether it's under an odd or an even root, is going to zero out inside as well. So I've got 2/5 times zero minus 6/13 times zero. And again, I could confirm that in a calculator. You'll have that available if we're kind of suspicious of that along the way. So I've really got 2/5 plus 6/13, and then I'm subtracting away zero. So this is all that remains of this problem. To get a common denominator, I would multiply this side by 13, and I would multiply this side by 5 to get a common denominator of 65. So we end up with 56 over 65, which does check out if we use numeric integration. And if we use Math 9. All right, problem number 3. This is one that probably would strike fear into many of you just because of the trigonometric nature of it. However, this is also just a straightforward anti-differentiation problem. You may be kind of hesitant because we see a trig function squared, thinking there's some u substitution here. There is not. Secant squared is the result of derivating tangent. So I'm derivating tangent to get to secant squared. My antiderivative is just that tangent theta. Okay, so when I actually plug in my upper bound and lower bound, I'm taking the tangent of a pi over 3 angle and subtracting away the tangent of a pi over 6 angle. And I may have to step off to the side and then sketch out, okay, pi over 3, that puts me in quadrant 1. I know pi over 3 is equivalent to 60, so I can fill in my x and y and r with a root 3 and a 1 and a 2. I know that the tangent is the y on x, that's root 3 over 1. And then let's go ahead and sketch out, this was pi over 3, let's sketch out a pi over 6. Again, just if we're doubting ourselves, we got a calculator to kind of help as well if needed. But I would hope that we could get an exact answer here and not need to round. We've also got a 30, 60, 90 in our pi over 6, except it's the 30 degree angle that's at the origin. So our y and x and r are 1, root 3, and 2 respectively here. The tangent of pi over 6, the y on x this time, is a 1 over root 3. All right, so to get a common denominator, multiply top and bottom by root 3. We end up with 3 minus 1 over root 3. We end up with 2 over root 3 or 2 root 3 over 3. Okay, and if we wanted to check that in a calculator, check with a decimal or something, this should be 1.155 rounded to three places, but it checks out. All right, and this is just more for practice than anything else. Your actual test, remember, is pared down from this review guide, but we can also have definite integrals that require that U substitution technique we covered in section 6.2. And so that's what we're starting to see here. Believe it or not, question 4, it can be done. It cannot be done as a U substitution. You may be looking at this and saying, hey, t to the third, if I derivate that, I get t to the second. But notice that t to the second, that derivative is divided. It's not multiplying onto that dt. It's being divided away. So U substitution falls apart pretty quickly. This one is just another anti-differentiation problem. But again, we have to clean up that integrand first. I've got subtraction over a common denominator. So if I take t to the third divided by t squared, I just get t. And if I subtract away, 1 over t squared is just t to the negative second dt. I can just use power rule here. My antiderivative is going to be 1 half t squared to antiderivate that t term. And then this would be just 1 over t, or t to the negative first, I should call it, going from 1 to 2. Now, just to make this easier to work with, I would suggest that you change this to 1 over t, just so it's easier to have an answer show up when you start plugging in the upper and lower bounds. But we're ready for that stage of the game. I've got 1 over 2 times my upper bound, that's 2 squared, plus 1 over that upper bound, 2, minus, now it's time to plug in the lower bound. I've got 1 half times 1 squared plus 1 over 1. So I've got half of 4 plus 1 half. Be careful, this negative does distribute, minus 1 half, and then minus 1. So we do get some terms that cancel out pretty quickly when we go to combine our like terms at the end. Final answer is going to end up being just 1. And that does check using numeric integration. Question number 5, here's the first where we encounter a need to use U substitution. You'll notice we got a lot of X's here, but I can't help but notice that this X squared minus X, that derivates to 2X minus 1. So this is definitely a U substitution problem because I've got a function and then its derivative is multiplied with my differential in here. So here's how we're going to phrase that. We're going to say let U equal that X squared minus X, and that's the toughest thing to find often. But if you look for what's contained within another function, in this case, that x squared minus x is contained within a square in the denominator, that's usually what you'd want to choose to be u. Okay, now if I derivate u, I end up with a 2x minus a 1, and I would multiply over the differential dx. Okay, and so my integral of from 3 to 2 is really 1 over u to the second, and then I'm multiplying that by 2x minus 1 dx, that is du. Now because this is a definite integral, I've left alone this 3 and this 2. Those are still x values in an otherwise u integral. So I'm going to go ahead and define those upper and lower bounds as u. So u of 2, my lower bound, is going to actually be 2 squared minus 2. That's going to equal 4 minus 2. It's going to be 2. Hell, that was fortunate. I also want to find u of 3, which is 3 squared minus 3. That's going to equal 6. So to get the integral fully into u territory, I'm actually integrating from 2 up to 6. 1 over u squared du. So now everything in there, my bounds, the integrand, the differential, everything is in terms of u, and now we can antiderivate and come up with our answer quite quickly. So 1 over u to the second, that had to be 1 over u to the first negative in order to get that antiderivative to shake out the right way. And you could go through calling this the integral with u to the negative second du, and then going backwards through your power rule to say, oh, that just had to be negative u to the negative first. But hopefully we've kind of found that pattern with 1 over something squared just by how much derivative work we've done in the class. All right, we're ready to plug in our upper bound and plug in our lower bound. So I've got negative 1/6 minus a negative 1/2. If I call this 3/6 instead, my answer is going to be positive 2/6 or 1/3. All right, now if I'm checking this work in a calculator, I would actually type in the original problem if I were using Math 9, because if I made like a distribution error or something early, I may get an answer that matches, like say, this integral that I had. But maybe there's a mistake in that work, and I did the rest of the work just fine, so these would match up. Go back to the original if you're going to check your work in a calculator, and sure enough, we do get a perfect match. All right, and problem number 6, the last of our definite integrals. Here, again, you can see I've got a sine and a cosine, but notice how that cosine is contained in a denominator under a square root. This is a good indication that u substitution is going to be my method, and we're going to let u equal the cosine of theta. Then derivating u, derivative of cosine is negative sine theta, multiply the differential over d theta, and we're good to go. That since it's a definite integral, let's go ahead and express our bounds. U of 0 is going to equal, what is the cosine at 0? Cosine at 0 is 1, and u at pi over 3. What's the cosine at pi over 3? That is 1/2. And so let's take a look at this integral, because there's some things that just aren't quite right. Notice we've got the sine theta d theta, but we needed that to be negative to have the differential, you know, substitutable with a du here. So I need to multiply a negative 1 inside the integral to make that du present. I also need to have a balancing 1, negative 1 multiplied out front. So now I've got negative 1 times that integral. And remember, these are still thetas. And inside, I've got 1 over the square root of cosine theta times, now it's negative sine theta d theta. So let's go ahead and swap everything with u values. So I've got that negative 1 out in front. I'm going from 1 to 1 half when I adjust my bounds into u territory. I've got 1 over the square root of u and du. All right, well, this is great. So let's antiderivate. Got that negative out front. That's easy to lose. And if you know properties of integrals, you know that our bounds are actually going in a reverse order, so that negative, technically, if we flip the bounds, would disappear. So that's an option, but I'm going to assume that we don't catch that, or maybe we have something a little bit messier out here. We'll just leave it for now. Our answer will still be fine. 1 over the square root of u is like u to the negative 1 half power. If I'm thinking in terms of, you know, power rule, and that's what we're going to be using here, you may be tempted to think natural log, but remember that has to have a linear, like u to the first something in our denominator. We do not have that. So it's power rule, which is good. That's easier to manage. That had to come from something u to the positive 1 half power. And I just needed something out front that would cancel that 1 half power when it multiplies. So I'm thinking a 2u to the 1 half should be it. So let's call that 2 root u. And we're going from 1 to 1 half. All right, well, let's go ahead and evaluate what's going on here. I've got a negative happening out in front of everything. If I plug in my upper bound, that's a 2 times the square root of 1 half. Okay, and then if I plug in my lower bound, that would be minus 2 times the square root of 1, which is just 1. Let's go ahead and distribute our negative in. Okay, and see how we can clean this up analytically. So I've got negative 2 times the square root of 1 half minus a negative 2. And when I square root a fraction like this, that's the square root of the top over the square root of the bottom. So this is really a negative 2 over root 2 plus a regular 2. If I establish a common denominator, I would multiply that regular 2 at the end by root 2 over itself. And so what I end up with is a negative 2 plus 2 root 2 all over the square root of 2 for an exact answer. And if we wanted to rationalize, I think we can clean this up even a little bit more, because I can multiply top and bottom. I have to remember to distribute here by root 2. Then I would have negative 2 root 2 plus 2 times 2 all over a regular 2. Yeah, this does clean up. So I end up with a negative root 2 plus 2 for that final answer. All right, and to work this out decimally, if I were just to type this into the home screen of a calculator, I would get 0.586. And checking with the original problem, I would type this into numeric integration, Math 9, exactly how I see it, maybe just using x's instead of thetas. It would do the same work to check out, but we get that confirmation. So, in short, you can expect to see your test open up with some antiderivative u substitution, but some definite integral problems that you can check with a calculator. And again, by this stage of the game, hopefully we're feeling pretty good about the mechanics involved. Next, we have the section where we're dealing with indefinite integrals. So we're kind of treating integration like an antiderivative operation. The big thing here is plus c. Do not forget plus C. When we antiderivate, there's an arbitrary constant that could be present. And if we do not have that, we're going to miss some very easy points, even if all of our other work is correct. So do not forget that. All right, so for problem number 7, this is actually just a straightforward antiderivative. There's no u substitution needed here, although you could use u substitution and still get an answer just fine. Okay, so here what I would do is I would just say, let's take a look at this as 2 minus 3y to the 1/3 power. Because we do not have like a second power or anything inside, we don't have to get super fancy with this. And I just want to think, what would derivate to this? Well, I'd have to have that 2 minus 3y to the 4/3 instead so that it would power down. And then when I derivate, I'd multiply a times negative 3 for the chain rule. So let's do times negative 1/3 to counteract that chain rule. All right, so what we end up with is a negative 1/3 times the cubed root of 2 minus 3y all to the 4th power. We get rid of our integral. That's when we should be throwing on the plus c right away. All right, now here you'll notice we can't really check with Math 9 in our calculator because it's not a definite integral. However, what you can do is you can check by derivating. Okay, so this is going to make this video quite a bit longer, but I want to make sure that I show you how to check your work if we're kind of suspicious about something. So if I start off with negative 1/3 times 2 minus 3y to the 4/3 plus c, and I throw a ddx its way, I derivate that monster, here's what's going to happen. The first term, I've got a surviving negative 1/3. That's a coefficient that survives derivation. And then I got a power rule. So I would multiply out that 4/3 power. I'd keep what had the 4/3 power. I'd keep that base the same and drop the power to a 1/3. And there's a chain rule of times negative 3. And that plus c would derivate to plus 0. So when I go ahead and start multiplying these together, the 1/3 and the negative 3, those multiply to make a 1, effectively canceling. Okay. And now what happened with my... Why is my 4/3? Oh, see, I totally did something wrong. I never accounted for the fact that 4/3 should be there. I'm so glad I did this. So I need to have something that undoes the power rule, and I did not. I had the chain rule accounted for, but I never accounted for the reciprocal that needed to be here. I needed a 3/4 probably tucked right in there to counteract the 4/3 that was going to multiply out front. So that should have been actually a negative 1/4 out front. Let's check that. Okay, so my 1/4 and 4 cancel out, my negative 1/3 and 3 cancel out, and I'm left with just a 1/3 power on 2 minus 3y. So it checks out by derivating. Man, what a perfect example for something like that to happen. That was unplanned, but holy cow, the ability, we're so fast with our derivative rules too, that those will often reveal simple little mistakes like that. Like I notice, hey, there's a 4/3 that's not canceling out. That wasn't here in the original integral. So what did I do wrong? Nice way to check our work. I'm really glad that happened. I hope that helps some people out. Number 8, here I've got a sine inside a 5th power. And then conveniently, this cosine x is the derivative of sine. So there's a product here that I can't use identities or anything to make the integrand simpler from the get-go. So this is definitely a u substitution problem. I don't know if I classified the last one as an anti-differentiation one. I should probably go back and do that. Again, these are just thought bubble things for the review and the video, not something that you need to include on your test by any means. All right, so let's let u equal the function inside the other, in this case, the sine of x that's inside that fifth power, then du would equal the cosine of x, and then I'd multiply the dx differential over. All right, so now my integral has u to the fifth power, and then cosine x dx, that is du. Let's go ahead and antiderivate. Fifth power needs to have a 1/5 out front, or sorry, 1/6 when I antiderivate, because it's going to go up to the sixth power, won't it? And then we got rid of our integral, so let's tack on a plus c. I do not want to box this up. Even though we've antiderivated, we started off with a function that has just x's inside the integral. We want our antiderivative to have just x's in it as well. So I'm just going to go back and substitute in that sine function for u. So now instead of u to the sixth, it's sine to the sixth of x. There's my answer. Let's do our derivative check. Maybe it'll reveal another careless mistake on my part. Who knows? If I were to take 1/6 times sine to the sixth x plus c and throw a derivation with respect to x at it, here's what we would see. The 1/6 is a surviving coefficient. I've got a sixth power, so the power rule happens next. So times 6, then the sine would drop to a fifth power with its x. Inside that sixth power was a sine function, so I need the derivative of sine, which was cosine. And inside the sine was just x, so the chain rule stops there. The plus c derivates to a plus 0. The 1/6 and the 6 beautifully cancel out, and I'm left with sine to the fifth x cosine x, which was my original integrand. That one checks out. Next, problem number 9. Here, again, inside this sine function, I've got something t to the fourth. Then I also have multiplied in my integrand t to the third. I know that power rule is going to take this, wipe out the 1, or sorry, chain rule is going to take the t to the fourth down to t to the third, and the 1 will disappear. So I kind of see that function within something else and part of its derivative, not the whole thing, but part of it present. This is definitely a u substitution problem. All right, we're just undoing the chain rule. So let's let u be that stuff inside the sine function. In that case, du, if I were to derivate this and do du dt, what I would get is the 1 derivating away to nothing, and the negative t to the fourth would turn into negative 4t to the third, and I'd multiply that dt in differential over to that side. And you can see I've got sine of u. Okay, that's great, but my du is not entirely present. I've got the t to the third dt, but I need to bring in a negative 4 to complete that. So I'm going to multiply a negative 4 inside the integral. I'm also going to multiply a negative 1/4 outside to keep my balance. So let's take a look at what we've got now. I've got a negative 1/4 outside. Inside, I've got my sine function with 1 minus t to the fourth. And then I also have now negative 4t to the third dt. And I just kind of rearrange that multiplication so that we can clearly see everything for du is present. We've kept our balance throughout. So I've got negative 1/4 times the integral of the sine of u du. Everything has been successfully converted from t's to u's. Let's antiderivate. I've got negative 1/4. Antiderivative of sine is a negative cosine. And we've got our plus c happening. If I multiply these back together, the coefficient negative 1/4 onto the negative cosine gives me positive 1/4 cosine. And instead of u, I want to put that 1 minus t to the fourth back inside so that my antiderivative perfectly matches the formatting of the integral we were given. All right, time for our derivative check. If I were to take 1/4 times the cosine of 1 minus t to the fourth plus c and derivate that with respect to the t variable it's using, so d dt, not like the pesticide, here's what would happen. We'd have a surviving coefficient of 1/4. we would have a cosine that derivates to negative sine of the stuff inside times the derivative of the thing inside, which would be negative 4t to the third. And the plus c would derivate away to plus 0. Constants derivate to 0. And if we multiply all this together, I get negative signs that will cancel, and I've also got a times 1/4 and a times 4. Those will effectively turn into a 1 and thus cancel out. So I'm left with a t to the third and a sine of 1 minus t to the fourth, which is exactly what I had in my integrand to begin with. It checks out. All right, more indefinite integrals. This problem number 10, it looks really different. It is a U substitution, but it's one of those like second tier U substitution. It goes a little bit beyond what we normally do, but it still works and it still makes sense really, really nicely. The problem with this is that if you notice inside, man, I would love if that were just an x squared plus 1, because then the derivative of that stuff inside the square root function here, the derivative is right there. But it's not. That's not a typo or anything. This is how this one's supposed to be represented. We are going to still let u equal the function inside something else. In this case, we're going to let u equal x plus 1. Notice that that means that du is equivalent to dx. And so what we're going to do here is we're going to actually manipulate this so that we have a replacement for the x plus 1. I can replace that with u, as we would normally do. But I also know that x is equal to u minus 1, right? These two guys kind of go hand in hand. If that's the substitution I'm going to use, I can also solve it for x. So now here's what I've got. I've got an indefinite integral, not with 2x in it anymore, but with 2 times u minus 1. And then I've got a square root, not of x plus 1, but just u inside. And I know that dx here at the end is the same thing as du, so I'm safe to substitute that. And notice we've converted everything to have u's and du's. So now where would I go from here with this? Well, what I would do is I would free the constant multiple of 2. That's a property of integrals that is incredibly helpful. And then this square root of u is really a u to the 1/2 multiplying into that u minus 1. So I actually get some distribution that can take place. This would be u to the 3/2 minus u to the 1/2 du. All right, let's antiderivate and bring plus c into the mix. So u to the 3/2 had to come from u to the 5/2. I just need to wipe out, kind of like one of our earlier problems, I need to wipe out that 5/2 with a 2/5 reciprocal. Similarly, u to the 1/2 had to come from u to the 3/2. I just need to wipe out that 3/2 with a 2/3 reciprocal. We got rid of the integral, so we can get rid of, so we can bring in the plus c now. Always a good idea to do that early. As soon as the integral symbol goes, plus c comes in if we're indefinite. All right, so what do I end up with for a final result here? I've got 4/5. I'm just distributing that 2 back in. 4/5 times u, which was x plus 1, to the 5/2 power, minus 2/3 times that x plus 1, to the 3/2 power plus c. Now, if this were a college board, this would be perfectly acceptable at this stage of the game. However, we know some greatest common factor tricks that can help us out here along the way. So just so you know, college board would deem this a fully correct answer if this were some part of an FRQ, but we're allowed to move on with this, and I think we should. I notice that I'm able to take a greatest common factor of 2 out, and I'm also able to take that quantity x plus 1 to the lower power out. So what am I going to be left with? I'm going to be left with a 2/5 times the quantity x plus 1 now to just the 2/2 or first power minus 1/3, and I've taken away all of that power plus c. So we have 2 times x plus 1 to the 3/2 times 2/5 x plus 2/5 minus 1/3 plus c And so we've got 2 times x plus 1 to the 3 halves. I hope I'm going about this the right way. Judging by how sloppy this looked, I'm guessing the derivative work is going to kind of either reveal a whole bunch of cancellations to us or leave us a little bit sad here. Let's take a look. 2 fifths x, and then my common denominator here would be 15. So this would be 6 fifteenths minus 5 fifteenths. So that would be plus 1 fifteenth. And that's not looking a whole heck of a lot better, is it? For my final answer, or expressing this a certain way, it looks like we're going to have to do a product rule to check by derivating. That's totally fine. We know how to do that. I'm actually going to choose to leave my answer in this format. However, you could call this the square root of x plus 1 to the third. And then inside the quantity that follows, you could redistribute that to, so times a 4 fifths x plus 2 fifteenths plus c, if we wanted to match their formatting a little bit more nicely there. Okay, so our derivative check. Okay, after going through all that work, I'm not imagining that we're going to have a lot of time left on the test to do work like this, but it's nice to know that it's still possible. If I were to take that 2, well here, let's distribute the 2 back in. If I were, no, 2 times x plus 1 to the 3 halves times 2 fifths x plus 1 fifteenth, and then plus c, and if we were going to go d dx on that whole thing, here's what would happen. So for the first term, I'm going to treat that product rule as this is the first, this is the second. Now it is a product rule. We could go back here even and check our derivative work there, which I am actually going to choose to do because I would much rather just do term by term than do this product rule, which I was just kind of getting at. So I'm actually going to check the 4 fifths times x plus 1 to the 5 halves minus 2 thirds times x plus 1 to the 3 halves. I'm going to check that with derivation. Okay, so for the first term, I've got a surviving 4 fifths, and then I've got a 5 halves power that would multiply out front, and my quantity, x plus 1, would drop to a 3 halves power. Thankfully, it was just x inside, so there's no chain rule or anything to worry about here. Then I would have a surviving negative 2 thirds for my second term times the 3 halves power that would come out front, and we would have x plus 1 drop to a 1 half power. The plus c would derivate away to nothing. Okay, the 4 fifths times 5 halves would actually reduce all the way down to a 2 times x plus 1 to the 3 halves. I'm kind of liking how this is looking. The 2 thirds times the 3 halves would derivate away to nothing. And we would be left with x plus 1 to the 1 half power there, wouldn't we? Now, let's do our sneaky GCF again. Let's take out just a factor of x plus 1 to the 1 half power. What I'd be left with is a 2 times x plus 1 to the first power minus a 1. And inside those brackets, if I distribute, I would have a 2x, and then I would have a plus 2 minus 1. Which is unfortunate, because when I look back, we are so close, but there's no plus 1 included up here in the original. Oh man, where did that come from? So let's see. Here's where it is. When I multiplied the 2 back in, it's way back here. I did change that to a 4 fifths here, but I neglected to change that. Go ahead and do this in pink to a 4 thirds here. So what that would do is that would change this to a 2 thirds. And I could have taken more out, I guess, now as I look at my greatest common factor work. This would be a 2 thirds here as well. And then 2/5, which would be 6/15 minus 10/15 is actually negative 4/15. And I know we didn't end up using this anyway, but that would allow us to simplify this answer a little bit further. We could take out a 4 now, you know, to tidy things up. Either way, these are going to be equivalent. Let's see what that did with our checking work when we come to the end here. If this were a 4/3 instead of a 2/3, then what would have happened? Then we would have had our 2 out here, but we would have also had this be a 2. And so then here we would have had minus 2. And that would have solved all of our issues, right? So it does check out. In case you were checking to see the doubters out there, it does check out as long as you don't make silly mistakes, like a distribution error that I made. Yeah, it looks pretty innocent, but it's actually kind of nasty. But U-substitution does the job. All right, problem number 11. Also, notice that I've got an x squared, you know, in a denominator and then x. So I can kind of see the power rule going from a second power and then a derivative making a first power here. U-substitution is likely my choice. Also, if we can't antiderivate, that's really the only other technique that we have. So that does help us out a little bit. All right, so with this one, I'm going to let u equal that x squared plus 1. Du would then be 2x dx, and you can see in my integral I have the x squared plus 1. That's all set up. It's just 1 over u, but I just have x times dx. I don't have the times 2, so I need to bring the times 2 in along with a balancing 1 half out front. Now everything from du is there, and I can substitute. That 1 half out front is there. I've got 1 over u du. Antiderivative of a 1 over is a natural log, so I have 1 half times the natural log of the absolute value of u plus c. We got rid of the integral, bring in the plus c. And we can go ahead and bring in our original. Now, take a note. When we antiderivate 1 over something linear like here, we do get natural log. We need the absolute values. However, take a look at what u is. It doesn't matter what x value I plug in. I'm always going to get something positive. So I'm safe without the absolute values here in this instance. There is my answer. Let's do a derivative check. That one was pretty fast compared to the last one. If I were to take that 1 half times the natural log of x squared plus 1 plus c and derivate that whole thing with a ddx, I would have a surviving coefficient of 1 half. Natural log would derivate to 1 over the thing inside times the derivative of the thing inside, which was 2x, and our plus c would derivate away to 0. So let's take a look at what happens. The 1 half and the 2 cancel out. I'm left with an x multiplied onto a 1 over x squared plus 1. That's our original integrand. It checks out. Now, some of the u substitutions are pretty obvious. So for this last one, that one, it was there, but it required a little bit of adjustment on our part with the 1 half and the 2 to make things kind of balance out as they should have. Some of them are way more obvious than you would think. So if you take a look here, underneath the square root, again, the function that's inside something else is x to the fifth plus 3x. And then take a look at what follows, 5x to the fourth plus 3. It's like a perfect derivative of that stuff inside. It's a pretty obvious u substitution in my eyes. And I hope you're thinking the same thing. All right, so if I let u equal that stuff that's under the square root, then du is just going to be 5x to the fourth plus 3 dx, which is exactly what I have multiplied on. This is fantastic. I don't have to do any balancing or any adjustment here. I've got the square root of what I said u was equivalent to, and I had everything in place for a du. Let's antiderivate. I'm just going to think of this as u to the 1 half. This is a power rule that we're antiderivating. It had to start off as something to the 3/2 power, and I need a 2/3 to counteract that power rule a little bit. Well, not a little bit, a lot bit, all the way. So I've got 2/3 times what I said u was equivalent to the 3/2 power, and then plus c. There's my answer. And again, proper formatting convention would say, hey, they started off with radical format in their answer, so switching to a rational exponent is not technically mathematically proper. Probably the best way to kind of format this answer would be the square root of that base to the 3rd power plus c. But anything that is numerically equivalent will be accepted, including in this class, so that's good here. Our derivative check. If I were to take that 2/3 times x to the 5th plus 3x to the 3/2 power plus c, and if I were to derivate that ddx, let's see what happens. I've got a surviving coefficient of 2/3. Then I've got a power that would multiply out 3/2. The stuff inside would remain unchanged. It would just drop to a 1/2 power, and then times the derivative of the thing inside, which is a 5x to the 4th plus 3. The plus c would, of course, derivate to plus 0. It's gone. If we multiply, we get some cancellations there, and a 1/2 power gives me the square root of x to the 5th plus 3x times the quantity 5x to the 4th plus 3. It checks out perfectly. All right, so if you can't tell, a lot of emphasis is placed on this test on just the mechanics of going through and antiderivating, either with an antiderivative or with a u substitution. Either way, we have ways to check that hopefully we're pretty confident with, whether it's some by hand derivative work or numeric integration in the calculator. The other big topic that we encountered was separating variables to solve an initial value problem. And these are differential equations. These are called ODEs when you get to the next level. So for number 13, here we've got dy dx equals y plus 2, and we know that y of 0 equals 2. So to solve the initial value problem means we go from a dy dx differential equation to a y equals function. And naturally, anti-differentiation is going to be a huge part of this. So I've got dy dx equal to this quantity that has y in it. So I'm going to divide away that y quantity to be with the dy differential. And then on the right, since I divided away this entirely, I'm essentially dividing it by itself. There's just a 1 over there to hold place. That's where the dx goes. All right, now we got to get rid of those differentials, the dy and the dx, and integration, antiderivating, will do just that. And so if we take 1 over y plus 2, we get the natural log of the absolute value y plus 2. And on the right, we have just x. We throw our constant of integration onto that side. Since we'll be solving for y, all of the plus c stuff is combined together on the right-hand side, just for ease of using our initial value. So we're going to sidestep for a moment to find out what c is actually equal to. We've done all of our antiderivating, and now it's time to find c before we solve for y. So I've got the natural log of y. My y value is 2 here. The output is 2, so I've got natural log of 4. That's positive, so I do not need the absolute values anymore. That equals my x value plus c, so I know that c equals the natural log of 4. Natural log of the absolute value of y plus 2 is equal to x plus the natural log of 4. Now we're just trying to solve for y. So to get rid of the natural log that's holding y hostage, we will raise both sides as a power on e. And we want to be careful. On the right-hand side, it's not e to the x plus e to the natural log 4. That entire thing is the power. Okay, so on the left, we get a beautiful cancellation, and we have just y plus 2. And on the right, we've got e to the x, and since we added exponents, it's like we had the same base of e multiplied, kind of borrowing a property of exponents to make that happen. We do get another cancellation. Y plus 2 equals 4 e to the x. And then finally, at long last, y equals 4e to the x. We'll subtract that 2 back over. That one's done. For number 14, naturally a little bit more involved differential equation. So let's take a look at what that looks like. We're going to use the same approach, though. I've got a quantity with x and a quantity with y. So I'm going to divide over the y quantity to join the dy differential on the left. I'm going to leave the 2x plus 1 on the right, but I'm going to bring over that dx differential, multiply that onto the right-hand side instead. We're ready to antiderivate. And on the left, it's a 1 over something linear, so natural log is my antiderivative there. And on the right, I have x squared plus x, and there goes my constant of integration. All right, we're going to sidestep. I know that when I get an output of 1, when I input an x value of negative 1, it's kind of tricky when they say y of, kind of like saying f of x, but this is our input value, even though we see it right next to y. It can be a little bit confusing. If I know my output y is 1, the left-hand side becomes natural log of 2, and that equals on the right x squared plus x plus c. However, I know that the x is a negative 1, so that would be 1 squared plus a negative 1 plus c if I actually substitute that in. We get a cancellation. So I find out that the actual value of c is natural log 2. So now I'm sitting with the natural log of the absolute value y plus 1, and that equals x squared plus x plus natural log 2. I now know the c value. It can go back in. Now we're just on the search for y. So again, our y is contained in a natural log. We'll use a base of e on both sides to help clean up that mess. All right, so on the left, we get a cancellation, and we are simply left with y plus 1. And on the right-hand side, I've got e to the x squared plus x times e to the natural log 2. And you'll notice I left this all grouped together, x squared plus x. I could call it e to the x squared times e to the x times e to the natural log 2. But since I won't get any further cancellation there, I just left that as a sum. You wouldn't be marked wrong if you split the whole thing up, like times e to the times e to the. It's just way easier this way to keep everything organized. All right, so here we've got y plus 1 equaling 2e to the x squared plus x power, and y will equal 2e to the x squared plus x power, and we'll subtract the 1 afterwards to finish solving for y. For problem number 15, here we've got dy dx equals x over y, and let's see. If we go ahead and multiply the y over to the left to join the dy, yes, now I'm multiplying, I'm not dividing. That's kind of a breath of fresh air for us. Then we've got x, we'll multiply the dx over with that side. Let's antiderivate. The y turns into a 1 half y squared on the left. The x turns into a 1 half x squared plus c on the right. Now, some of you may be thinking, oh, can't we just multiply both sides by 2 right here and then just call this 2c if you want? You're totally able to do that, but it's almost like a hornet's nest and we've got a stick in our hands. You know, when you get to this point, if you feel good about the antiderivative work, I would caution you not to simplify too much right now because you're just poking the hornet's nest. There's a whole bunch of like really simple mistakes that you could make. You're complicating the substitution that could happen. It may mean a little bit more work to go through this right now, but personally going through these, I think that this is a much safer route. So I've got 1 half times y squared, that would be 1 half times 4, and that equals 1 half times x squared, which is 1 half times 1 plus c. So I've got 4 halves equaling 1 half plus c. If I subtract a half from each side, I find that c equals 3 halves. And then I just substitute that back in. So 1 half y squared equals 1 half x squared plus 3/2. And so it's now, once I've found the C value and I haven't altered anything about this plus C, now I feel good plugging it back in and then saying, okay, now I can do my simplifying as I finish solving for Y. So remember, Y is a function. So we're gonna notice that we're gonna have to take the square root of both sides. Let's multiply both sides by 2. Now we can do that. And if I want to solve for y, I'm going to have to take a square root, which means plus or minus. So y is going to equal, I'm going to leave a little space there for plus or minus, the square root of x squared plus 3. I've got to use my initial condition here. When I plug in an x value of 1, my output is going to be a positive 2. So I don't want to put plus or minus here. I want to leave that as just being positive so that when I do have this initial condition, it actually shows up. If I were to plug in the x value of 1, I actually get something that is the positive square root of 2, the positive 2 coming out of that. So there is our answer. There are times, though, if they said y1 equals negative 2, then I would put a negative sign there to make sure that my function leads to that condition that was given. Okay, now the keen-eyed observer will notice that we just did problem 16 or 15, and then we moved to problem 19. This should be a 16 instead. That'll be fixed by the time you get your copies. But if you're checking your work here, you probably notice that jump. I've rearranged some things and forgot to change the numbering when I did so. All right, so the last thing is having us think of the integral as a function. So this is using the Fundamental Theorem of Calculus Part 1 to say, hey, we've got a function that means I integrate f going from 0 to some x value, and that's where my input is. All right, so our first task here is to evaluate this function g at a number of different values. So I'm going to go ahead and make a little table here that is an x value. And then what am I getting for g at that x value? They tell me to evaluate g at 0, 1, 2, 3. And then they have me skip over 4 and 5 and go right to 6. But I've got this nice little piecewise graph. There's lots of little triangles and rectangles there that I can find areas and stuff with. I'm going to go ahead and just do everything. And then I'll just report these 5 as my final answer. So at 0, g of x is telling me to go from 0 to 0. On my graph of f. Now they use t here just as a dummy variable. They don't want us to mix up the x for our input with the actual function itself. So once I have a number plugged in there, I can refer to this as f of x again. It's just fine. And we know that when we take an integral and the bounds, lower and upper, are identical, that the output is going to be 0. So I've found that g of 0 equals 0. I'm going to go ahead and make a list of my answers here. The integral as I go from 0 to 1 on f is going to be this next value. Okay, I should be color coding this. Okay, so we'll go light blue for the next one. So when x equals 1, our integral is going from 0 to 1 on f of x dx. So let's find that. We don't know what the function is. We can't do an antiderivative. Let's just do an area. And thankfully, this is just a rectangle. I can see those three boxes there. This is 3. G of 1 equals 3. For the next one, if x equals 2, now my integral is going from 0 to 2 on f of x. And so let's take a look at what happens when I go from 0 to 2. Well, now I have a couple different ways of doing this. I could see it as a trapezoid, which I will choose to do. Or we could see, you know, just the pink part as a trapezoid and add that on to the blue part that we had up above. Either way, you're going to be fine. So we're actually going to take that value of 3, and we're going to add to it this little trapezoid of pink. So that is one base that is 3 units tall, another base that is 1 and 1/2 units tall. So base plus base divided by 2 times a height of 1. So I've got 3 plus 3 over 2 plus 3 over 4. And that is 3 plus 6 fourths, 9 fourths. So 12 plus 9 is 21 fourths if I get a common denominator. And again, you'll be allowed a calculator to check this and help out and everything like that. G of 2 is 21 fourths. All right, next, what color should I use next? How about green? If x is 3, now if I go all the way here, I would say that this integral going from 0 to 3 on f of x, I could take 21 fourths and just add on this extra triangle, or I could see this as the rectangle that is 3 plus the triangle that has a base of 2 and a height of 3 plus 1 half times 2 times 3. I get 6 there. Okay, I'll go ahead and clean those up just for sake of having this look beautiful. All right, next, 4. Now my integral is going from 0 to 4 on f of x dx, and this is something that we weren't asked to find, so it's not crucial that we do this work, but it's kind of nice to see the picture the whole way around. So I've built up all the way up to 3 some positive area, and then when I continue that onto 4, notice that the area I'm finding is now underneath the x-axis, so this is negative area. So I've got that 6 that I just accounted for minus 1 half unit. So that gives me 11 over 2 for g of 4. Let's go ahead and keep rolling and find g of 5. If I were to go from 0 to 5 on f of x dx, what I would then do is just take away another one box of area, because we've got negative 1 unit of area showing up under the x-axis. 11 halves minus 1 is 9 halves. And then lastly, when I get to 6, I think I'm almost out of color. I haven't used red yet. So if I go all the way to 6, now my integral from 0 to 6 of f of x dx, it's kind of been nice that I've been building this as I go along. I can kind of keep referring back to my previous work. It kind of looks like the German flag there. Shout out to Deutschland there. So from 0 to 6, I'm going to take that 9 halves that I'd already accumulated, and I got to subtract away another unit. We've got one more unit underneath the x-axis, one more negative unit. We get 7 halves there. So let's see, what did I forget to put in there? Oh, I never said g of 3 is 6. And then lastly, we found that g of 6 is equal to 7 halves. Okay, so this is what I was asked to contribute for an answer. We kind of made a table of values. You do not have to write this much out. If you're able to do just some scratch geometry work off to the side and have this for an answer, that is fine. This was just to organize everything for the video and kind of show how we were getting those numbers a little bit more. So I hope that made sense. All right, letter B says, on what intervals is function g increasing? Well, there's one big thing that we have to make note of. Note, g prime of x is going to be the same thing as taking the derivative of an integral going from 0 to x of f of t dt. The derivative of an integral is just going to be the function inside, and we don't have any chain rule, no part one with a twist here. It's just going to be f of x. So g prime is f of x. So g of x is increasing when g prime of x, which equals f of x, is greater than 0. This occurs on the interval from 0 up to 3. All right, so that takes care of the justifying along the way as we go through and explain this this process. But that increasing prompt, we're looking at where is the derivative positive. All right, where does g have a maximum value? Justify your answer. Okay, g of x has a max where g prime of x, which we just said was f of x, switches positive to negative. All right. Now, if we go through and say where this occurs, we notice that, hey, the graph of f goes from being above the x-axis to below when we hit x equals 3. So this occurs at x equals 3. Now, you could also, if you went through and evaluated all of these points up above, you could use like the candidates test and just kind of compare your outputs here and say that the highest output happened when x equaled 3 as well, if you want to be a little bit more thorough and look at endpoints and critical points. However, they do not specify if it's an absolute or a local max, so this suffices. And lastly, letter D, sketch a rough graph of g of x. Now notice our function here, which was that piecewise linear graph, that came out nice and connected. It's continuous, which means I should see no corners or sharp edges on this. It should be a nice smooth graph. So let's go ahead and plot out our points from our table of values up above. We have 0, 0. We have the point 1, 3. We have the point 2. And then 21 over 4, what's that going to be? That's going to be 5 and 1 fourth. Then we have the point 3, 6. And then if we did not do the 4 and 5 because that was not requested, we would get 6 and then 7 halves or 3 and a half. So it's tempting to connect these nice and straight. But let's take a look when I fill in those missing values. At 4, we're at 11 halves. And then at 5, we're at 9 halves. Okay, so what you see showing up here is there's actually a little bit of curvature there until we get to 4. Okay, and that makes sense. We're just trying to make the slope of this graph match up with what we're being shown here in the first part. So from 0 to 1, notice we had a constant derivative. So that means a constant derivative, this must be a linear portion of the graph. Then we have from 1 to 3, this rate of change that is a negative 3 over 2. So that's a linear rate of change, meaning we need to be parabolic with our derivative as we go through those points. And then lastly, going from 4 to 6, that's where I see a constant slope of negative 1. I want to make sure that I'm holding true to that derivative relationship, and this last stretch is linear. So there are some details there that can influence the scoring on this slightly. But what an awesome exercise that connects some familiar language about derivative work. It brings the fundamental theorem of calculus into the mix and really has you analyze something even when there's no function given. Very, very wonderful problem. That does it for our Chapter 6 review, everybody. Happy studying to you all, and thank you for watching.